knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Earlier in this series, we spent several tutorials going over the nervous system. The starting place for that investigation was the central nervous system, and in particular, the brain. We often describe the brain as the most complex object in the known universe, consisting of hundreds of billions of cells linked by trillions of connections, producing our own consciousness through mechanisms that are not yet fully understood. When we first learned about the brain, we were interested in outlining its overall structure, naming each region, and describing their functions. But when concerning oneself with so many definitions and details, it can be difficult to visualize the overall three-dimensional layout of such a complex object. For this reason, just as we took a realistic journey through the heart in the previous tutorial, let's now get a closer look at some of the areas of the brain from a more lifelike perspective, as this will help us concretize what we learned earlier in the series and solidify our conception of brain structure and function. Let's start out on the smaller scale and take a look at some neurons. We spent a whole tutorial looking at the action potential and synaptic transmission over in the biopsychology series, so we should have a sense of how neuronal cells communicate with one another. Now we can observe the process in action. Of course, we know that in addition to the neurons themselves, nervous tissue contains many different types of glial cells, such as the oligodendrocytes we can see here, providing support and insulation to the axons via a myelin sheath. This speeds up the rate of transmission through the axon. These myelinated axons, also called tracts, are what make up the white matter of the brain. The white matter allows the different regions of the brain to communicate with one another efficiently, and is thereby responsible for a wide variety of brain function, being heavily involved in learning and memory. This should offer a more complete picture of what is being visualized when we examine a cross-section of the brain. This sort of image should be recognizable from any textbook, but with this three-dimensional representation, the distribution of white matter should make a bit more sense. However, when viewing the brain in this fashion, the innermost structures of the brain can become unclear. Let's get a closer look at those as well. Starting with the areas that are most crucial to memory, we can head to the bottom of the brain to find the cerebellum. Then, heading inside, we see the hippocampus glowing in green, the center of memory and emotion, and the thalamus glowing in purple, relaying sensory and motor signals. Then there is the amygdala in yellow, also heavily involved in the experience of emotions. And then zooming back out to the frontal lobe, which is concerned with behavior and learning, among other things. We can visualize all the lobes while we're at it, with the frontal lobe in dark blue, the parietal lobe in green, the occipital lobe in light purple, and the temporal lobe in light blue. Now let's head back inside to get another look at the innermost structures. Apart from the cerebellum, we can now clearly see the entire brainstem, leading up to the limbic system, that collection of structures surrounding the thalamus. If we strip away these structures, we can get a closer look at the region in bright blue. This is the choroid plexus, along with the rest of the ventricular system, which is continuous with the central canal of the spinal cord via the fourth ventricle, the larger structure towards the bottom. The choroid plexus produces cerebrospinal fluid, the fluid found in the tissue that surrounds the brain and spinal cord, occupying the subarachnoid space between the arachnoid mater and pia mater, protecting the brain from injury. Of course, this is not the only fluid in this region. All of these structures are comprised of cells, and thus need to be serviced by the bloodstream. So here are all the major blood vessels that are involved in brain circulation. With these structures and the overall layout better understood, we can view a sagittal slice of the brain with more clarity as well. Here we see the brain cut vertically down the middle, revealing a cross-section of many of the features we just went over. The more one learns about the human brain, that magnificent organ and vessel for human imagination, the more one can appreciate its complex structure. So with that sentiment, I will leave you with a bit more footage of the brain in all its glory. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.